stewardship, what is the first feeling that you get? Is it positive? Is it negative? Is it joy? Or is it anger? Are you excited when you hear a message on stewardship? Or are you uncomfortable? This week we're going to start a series on stewardship called The Grace of Giving. The Grace of Giving. Now, this, I hope, will be a different type of series than you're used to hearing as it relates to stewardship, because stewardship means more than just our personal finances.
Right.
Stewardship means our resources as it relates to time.
Yes.
Our gifts, our abilities that God has given us. Everything that God has graced us with, we are responsible for managing in a way that is pleasing to God.
Amen.
And unfortunately, when you hear that word stewardship so many times, it brings up a negative connotation. But those of you who are in this audience know that I have been the pastor since we started this church 5 years ago. I have not done one single message on giving in 5 years. Giving, when I began this church, I made a promise to myself that when it came to money, I would never allow it to influence my decisions. I would never allow it to impact myself and the way that I saw people. That I would not allow it to control me, and I would not allow it to control this church. But in doing so, I have neglected a very basic premise as it relates to God's Word. Because stewardship is the very first thing that God gave Adam in the Garden of Eden. He said to Adam, I give you dominion over everything. All the fruit of the garden is yours, except for the tree of knowledge of good and evil. The animals, I'm going to bring them to you, and you're going to name them. You will rule over and have dominion over everything that God has created, that I have created. So stewardship is a principle that was laid down by God when He created man in the Garden of Eden. It's serious as it relates to God. God expects you and I to faithfully serve Him with the resources that He has given us. See, you and I do not deserve anything that we have. As it relates to money, as it relates to possessions, as it relates to talents, as it relates to gifts, as it relates to abilities, your health is a gift. Your physical acumen is a gift. Your mental acumen is a gift. That are gifts that you and I do not deserve that God graciously gives to us. I think that is where it all starts as it relates to stewardship, is recognizing that nothing belongs to me. If I had a Ferrari in the parking lot that was in my name, paid for, didn't belong to the bank, it was in my name, I had the insurance on it, my name's on the title, it's mine. But if I give you the keys to say that you can use that for a week, I am now delegating the authority to you to use it and trusting you to use it in a responsible manner. I'm going to give you the keys. Now, does that mean it doesn't belong to me anymore?
No.
Absolutely not. Should you appreciate the fact that I gave you the keys and said, use this car for your purposes this week?
Yes.
You should appreciate it. I should appreciate it. Here you go. Go wine and dine your wife. Wives, go wine and dine your husband, right? Whatever the case may be, it is yours, but I expect you to take care of it. I used to travel a lot, and so we would get lots of rental cars. And I traveled with a group of guys, and their philosophy was that if it's a rental car, you could do whatever you wanted in it. So them jokers would take rental cars and deliberately go to where there were big speed bumps and they would hit them jokers as fast as they could and jump them. I watched a gentleman take a automatic and using just gears 1 and 3, drive it down the interstate as fast as he could, and he was driving like a sports car, shifting between 1 and 3, even though it was an automatic. Not one of them fancy Cheftronics where you could go into manual when you want to. No, it was a minivan that was never meant to do that. And it was amazing. They weren't good stewards because the car did not belong to them. It was being leased or rented to them for a specific purpose, and they were supposed to be responsible for it. That is being irresponsible for it. If they broke something on the car, it would need to be fixed. If something was damaged, it would have to be fixed. Okay? If I were to loan you my Ferrari and give you the keys and say it's all yours, if you crashed it, right, that's not being responsible with it. Somebody's got to fix it. And as it relates to stewardship, if we do not properly handle the resources, the gifts that God has given us, we cause messes that have to be fixed.
Right.
Financial messes that have to be fixed. Mm-hmm. We cause messes in our family that have to be fixed when we're not proper stewards of what God has given us. We cause huge messes in our lives when we're not accomplishing God's purpose and we're running from Him and we're afraid and we're angry and we're bitter. That's being poor stewards. And so as we start this message, I want you to understand that I'm hoping that you'll take it for what it is and that you will understand that it is about everything that God has given you and I stewardship over. So with that, we'll look at 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verses 1 through 7. We want you to know, brothers, about the grace of God that has been given among the churches of Macedonia, for in severe test of affliction, their abundance of joy and their extreme poverty have overflowed in a wealth of generosity on their part. For they gave according to their means, as I can testify, and beyond their means of their own accord, begging us earnestly for the favor of taking part in the relief of the saints. And as this, not as we expected, but they gave themselves first to the Lord, and then by the will of God to us. Accordingly, we urge Titus that as he has stated or started, so he should complete among you this act of grace. But as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in all earnestness, and in our love for God, see that you excel in this act of grace also. Over the next few weeks, we're going to be looking at the Macedonians as it relates to their attitude regarding stewardship. The people in Jerusalem were suffering. They did not have resources. And so Paul was collecting, offering to take back to Jerusalem to help alleviate the fact that they were did not have enough food, they did not have enough water, they were suffering financially. And he was going to take it back to the brothers and sisters of Christ there in Jerusalem. And that's the baseline of what we're seeing today. And so the Macedonians said, even though they were poor, and even though they were afflicted, and even though they were under great stress and tribulation, they not begrudgingly, but they begged Paul to allow them to bless the church in Jerusalem so that they could serve them with what they had. Now, as we begin this, we're going to look first at three dilemmas related to the adequate understanding of grace as it relates to stewardship. The first one is the spiritual dilemma. Many times when there are a lack of resources in the church, ministries are obstructed because they don't have the support they need. They lack the financial resources to do what God has purposed to be done. They lack the manpower to do what God has purposed to be done. That is a spiritual dilemma. Ministry cannot take place the way God intended. Vision, mission cannot be completed because of a lack of support. And the second one is that a negative attitude about stewardship and giving develops, right? Whenever a preacher gets up to preach and they start talking about money, the prevalent attitude in society is they're just begging for money. Money is all that's important to them. Money is all they care about, but that's not the case whatsoever. Money is a piece, but resource management, it includes everything that God has given us. And so people resist any kind of preaching, any kind of teaching as it relates to stewardship. And as a result, spiritual problems arise within the church and arise within the families of the church because they are not properly managing the resources that God has given them. The testimony of the church is negatively impacted because when a church is not serving its purpose, or a church cannot pay its bills, it is a poor reflection to everyone around them. When a church is charging up credit card debt, hand over fist, that is a poor, poor example to the world and to their creditors. When a church cannot pay its bills or is constantly late paying its bills, that is a poor testimony to the world around them. When the church is inward focused and cannot go beyond its walls because of a lack of resources and support, it is a poor testimony to the world around us. A faithful few end up bearing the overwhelming majority of responsibility as it relates to the church. You hear the old adage in the private sector that 20% of the people do 80% of the work. I'm here to tell you that after being in church since I was 5 years old, that is true in church. 20% of the people do 80% of the work, meaning 20% of the people support financially, faithfully. 20% of the people show up and help do ministry. They do 80% of everything that needs to get done. When we don't have a proper attitude towards stewardship, the church suffers, and I'm going to tell you, it builds resentment in the 20% that are doing what they are supposed to do. Now, I know we're all Christians and that we're all supposed to do everything that we do for God, and that is obviously the truth, but I can tell you that after a lot of years, you begin to grow resentful when you're the only one showing up to anything. You begin to grow resentful when the church can't do ministry or cannot help reimburse you for something as you're doing ministry because they lack the finances required to do that. It causes resentment. It puts an overwhelming burden on those who are supporting the ministry properly, who are being good stewards. It will cause morale problems to spread throughout the church. A church that has monetary problems, resource management problems, is unstable. It's double-minded. It's trying to meet financial and resource needs, and it cannot focus on the spiritual. And I believe it was James that said, a double-mindedness has no place within a Christian. You cannot focus both on the world and the spiritual realm and reconcile the two.
Amen.
It's what causes churches to start to use unscriptural methods to raise funds. To use coercion to get support. Intimidation to try to get people to do what they're supposed to do. Which is not scriptural whatsoever. Financial bondage will paralyze a church. And ultimately, the greatest spiritual consequence and dilemma is that the church and its members lose the blessings associated with being good stewards. Now, if you're like me, when I was young, sitting and listening to a pastor talk about giving, I would say, those blessings are so intangible. Prove it to me. Right? Because the blessings that God promises as we are good stewards, both with our finances and also with our talents, our abilities, are not always tangible. They're intangible. And so we hear, with, again, cynicism as it relates to being good stewards. As we talk about blessing, that that's just something pastors say to get me to do more, get me to give more. But you see, when you and I love God, no one should have to beg us to be faithful.
Amen.
The second dilemma is the organizational dilemma. Numerical growth is stifled because there are insufficient funds and resources to support the ministry. You can't get out of your own way. You can't get out beyond the four walls of the church. You can't advertise. You can't do mailings. You can't get out and do ministry in the community because you don't have the resources, and so therefore growth is stymied by that. Hmm. Now, granted, I believe 100% that God sends people, but we are His hands and feet that must go out and share God with those people. We have a responsibility to go out and minister and to bring people in. A loss of confidence as it relates to proper stewardship and the management of resources will cause a leader to become ineffective. Now, I strive very strongly to not allow anyone's giving. In fact, up until recently, I never looked at giving records. I got a big number that said this is what came in for the month and for the year, and I didn't care or focus on anything else. I promised that I would not allow that to negatively impact my attitude towards anybody. I wanted to be above, beyond board as it relates to that. But I can tell you that when you begin to look at your people that you shepherd and they're not giving of their financial resources faithfully, and they're not giving of their talents and their abilities faithfully, it causes a leader to question everything that they do. It causes a leader to question, what am I doing wrong? Why is this happening? Why are people not serving? And it causes them to be ineffective because they're worried, always looking for the other shoe to drop, always worried about pleasing people. Why? So I'm going to please people. I'm going to be nice to people. I'm going to shake everybody's hand, trying to get them to serve. And it causes leadership to be ineffective. One of the things that I like to do is I pride myself on being real to you. I reveal stuff to the church that I probably should never reveal. But when a pastor feels like he's ineffective, that transparency goes away because he feels like he has to be something he's not to get people to support him. And the final dilemma as it relates to stewardship is the physical dilemma. Inadequate giving and resource management creates inferior programs, materials, and facilities. How do I say this? Have you ever watched a Christian TV show and wondered where their budget came from?
Mm-hmm.
Say, compare it to Law and Order.
Mm-hmm.
Right? They don't have the resources to hire the big name actor or the big time special effects and CGI and all that nonsense. And so, therefore, they produce an inferior product. Now, I happen to watch those things, right? God's Not Dead too, you know, War Room. But when you measure them up to what the world produces, they don't come close. Come on now. Come on. And it's because they don't have the budget to be able to match what Hollywood is doing. They don't have the budget to do what the world is doing. And that is disgraceful, that the church produces subpar resources because the Christians in the body of Christ do not support the church, but they will support Hollywood.
Amen.
They go to the movies. They go to Starbucks. Come on. They go into the world and give their money freely to programs and stuff like that. Netflix and cable TV. devil produces should ever outshine what God produces.
Amen.
But if man is not faithful, if Christians are not faithful with their resources, we stymie God's hand. We know that God can take a little and make a lot, but many of us don't even give the little. So when I don't give the little, God ain't got nothing to work with.
Right?
And so it causes a dilemma. Inferior programs, inferior resources, the building falls apart. Ministry materials are pathetic. They don't meet proper standards. So, with those dilemmas in mind, as it relates to stewardship, let's begin to look at what stewardship means in terms of grace. When you heard the word grace, what's the first thing that pops in your mind? For me, it's salvation. God's unmerited favor upon me, where I did not deserve salvation, could not work my way to be good enough, cannot be obedient enough to the law. So God sent his only son into the world to die for me, to be raised from the dead so that I could be saved. That is the Christian's main focus on grace, what God did for us as it relates to salvation. But grace is so much larger as you begin to study Scripture, that grace isn't just about salvation, that unmerited favor isn't just about salvation, that unmerited favor is extended into our everyday lives. So we have saving grace, and we have living grace. Saving grace and living grace. Living grace is that God-given desire, ability, and strength to do God's will. If you look with me to Hebrews chapter 12, verse 28, it clearly says that grace is a God-given desire to accomplish God's purpose in our lives. The author writes, therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us have grace by which we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. It is that desire to do what God has purposed in our lives. That's grace, folks. You ever think about grace that way? That it is God's unmerited favor upon your life to give you a desire to serve him? That's grace. So instead of just focusing on what God did for us through salvation, we can look at grace as God giving us a desire to serve him.
Amen.
To do for him. To accomplish his will. To accomplish his purpose. That's grace, guys.
Amen.
Romans chapter 12, verse 6 says, having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, let us use them. So God gives us not only desire, he gives us the ability to accomplish his purpose and his will. That's an act of grace. What did we say at the beginning of this? I didn't earn and deserve any of this.
Amen.
That is an act of God's grace. God's grace to give me a desire. God's grace giving me the ability, the talents, the gifts that I need to accomplish his purpose and his will. When God made you, he didn't make you so that you have no talents and abilities. He made you with those things. He gave you physical strength. He gave you good health. He gave you mental strength. He gave you the ability to reason and think. Some of us more than others as it relates to those ideas, and he expects us to use those in accomplishing his purpose. He didn't give them to us so that we would not use them.
Amen.
You ever seen The Matrix? In The Matrix, they're all plugged into a machine. Now they think they're in the real world, but what you discover is they're actually being used by machines like batteries. And so the humans are in these capsules. They never use their muscles. They never use anything physically in their bodies. They're in a capsule and everything is in their mind. Dreaming, essentially. Dreaming about life. When they're awoken and they are brought up and rescued from the machine, they have never used their muscles before. They've never really used their eyes before. So it is a long process to begin to rebuild the eyes so that they can function in the real world. Some of us are like that in that we haven't used our resources so to the point our talents, our gifts, our abilities, that they become atrophied. Oh, we imagine and dream about what it would be like, and we think about how good it would be, but we never flex or do. I mean, I can say I'd sure like to look like Thor, but if I never pick up a weight, guess what? Brother's never going to look like Thor. I can imagine all day long, but guess what? In my DNA is the ability, if I work hard and have a right diet, to sculpt my body so that I have more than a keg, I have abs. Right? But I've got to use the ability of what God's given me to get to that point. I have to be a good steward. If I'm not, it becomes harder and harder and harder to do. The older you get, the harder it is to change your body. Right? And we do that with God. We are just like that servant who buried his talent in the ground because he was afraid the master would be upset if he lost it. We squirrel it away as bad stewards. We never use it, and it never accomplishes the purpose and the impact that it was supposed to have. It's atrophied. It's not potent like it is supposed to be. Next, God's living grace gives you and I the strength to accomplish the purpose he has for our lives. So he gives us the desire. That grace gives us desire, the ability, and the strength. Hebrews 4:16 says, "Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need." When you and I need strength, God is there through his grace to give us strength. We can find grace to help in time of need. God's favor on us to give us strength to serve him when we feel like we're too weak to serve him or too weak to keep going on. Amen. That's an act of grace. I don't deserve it. I can't earn it. God in his grace gives me the ability to do that. If you look at the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 12, it is one of the very famous passages that Paul writes when he says, "I had a thorn in my flesh. And I prayed 3 times for God to take that thorn away. But God said, no, my grace is sufficient for you." God's grace to sustain us when we're hurting, when we are afraid, when we feel like we can't take another step forward. That is an aspect of grace that we don't properly utilize or understand. We like the emotional part of it, getting excited, God will do this, God will do that, God will do this. We don't understand that's an act of his grace. We don't deserve it, and we can't earn it. Amen. To give us the strength to make it through those things, to be able to serve him in spite of circumstances. And because in our weakness, God can make us strong in his grace. Because it is not an act of me, it is an act of God. I can't deserve it, I don't earn it. It is unmerited favor upon me and upon you. And then finally, this living grace is the God-given desire and strength to give beyond human ability. 2 Corinthians 8, verses 1 through 4 says, "We want you to know, brothers, about the grace of God that has been given among the churches of Macedonia. For in a severe test of affliction, their abundance of joy and their extreme poverty have overflowed in a wealth of generosity on their part. For they gave according to their means, as I can testify, and beyond their means, of their own accord, begging us earnestly for the favor of taking part in the relief of the saints." Grace gave the Macedonians the ability that in spite of what they were facing in their lives, persecution, lack of resources, they did not have tons of money saved up. They didn't have tons of food stocked up. But God's grace gave them the ability to give what they had, what they could spare, is probably a better way of saying that. To give what they could spare. Come on, I'm guilty of only giving God what I could spare. Come on. They didn't just give God what they could afford to live without. They gave God what they could afford to live without, plus some. Now that's hard. That's why it's God's grace that gives us the ability and the strength to do that. That gives us the desire to do that. See, God's unmerited favor towards us should cause us to want to give God everything that we have. And in His grace and mercy, He only wants the first fruits. He can take it all and be in His right. But He does not because of His favor towards you and I. Right?
Right.
God's grace gives you and I the strength, and in spite of what we're going through, to give what we or what God should be given. What we can afford and above what we can afford. Now, I'd be a hypocrite if I stood up here and told you that there have been times in my life where I haven't gone through something very, very tough and I had a lack of faith. Hmm. Come on.
Yep. Amen.
You're in this room, you know exactly what I'm talking about. It's okay to admit it.
Yep.
I'll cut you out and on the thing. You know, they won't hear your voice. They'll just hear mine acknowledging my sin.
He's so funny.
But we've all been there.
Amen.
And I've made the right decision sometimes. I've made the wrong decision sometimes.
Yeah.
And as much as I hate to admit it, I've probably made the wrong decision more than I've made the right decision.
Yeah.
To not only give what I could spare, but to give beyond that. See, tithing, while loved to be talked about by preachers, is an Old Testament concept. Right? Giving 10% was defined by for the Levites so they could survive. The problem is that a lot of churches have to put the 10% mark down in the ground because if they didn't, people wouldn't give anything. Come on. If you look at the book of Acts, they gave above and beyond. They were selling everything that they had. They were giving, 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 giving. No one had to go, hey, buddy, you need to give me 10% so that the disciples could do their jobs. Or so that the widows could be fed. Or so that the orphans could be taken care of. They, in God's grace, gave everything that they had. They all had everything in common. And they lived and did what God had for them to do. That would be like us all getting one big joint checking account and putting our paychecks in it every month and doling it out as everyone has need. I'm too selfish to do that. But that's what they did. They were selling their land, everything. They had all things in common. No one had to put a line in the sand and say, you at least need to give 10%. Because if we recognize that everything that we have that belongs to God, we will give more than 10%.
Mm-hmm.
We will give more than the minimum. We will give way above the minimum. We'll give more than just tithes. We still call it tithes and offerings, but the truth of the matter is, it is an offering to the Lord. And God expects us to be faithful with that offering. And He gives us the grace to do that if we will recognize that it doesn't belong to us in the first place.
Amen.
So let's look at the operation of living grace. The yellow dot is one. That is God's grace as it relates to unmerited favor and salvation that you and I experience. The orange dot is that when you and I accept Christ as Lord and Savior, we have responsibilities as Christians. Right? All of us have base responsibilities despite of what God has called you specifically to do. We're to witness, we're to pray, we're to suffer, we're to sacrifice, we're to serve, and we're to give. That is, regardless of what you are specifically called of God to do, We all have responsibilities that are for every believer, which is witnessing, praying, suffering, sacrificing, serving, and giving. So we have those responsibilities. The brown dot at the bottom is, that's living grace. So you have God's unmerited favor, grace, and salvation. You have the responsibilities that come with being a Christian. God then gives us his living grace to accomplish those responsibilities, right? And then that grace, the last one there, is obedience. God gives us the grace to accomplish those responsibilities, and we step out in obedience. So saving grace, responsibilities, living grace, obedience. And it creates a cycle that if we follow, will create abundant life. That's the big one in the middle. So God's unmerited favor as it relates to salvation. We get responsibilities as believers as a result. God gives us the living grace to accomplish those responsibilities and much, much more. And as we're obedient, the circle continues. And God continues to give grace and grace and grace, right? John 1:16 says, and of his fullness we have all received grace for grace. Literally that means grace upon grace. Meaning that God's grace will never be exhausted. So as long as you keep being obedient, he will keep giving you the grace to be obedient.
Amen.
As long as you and I keep being obedient and serving him and doing what we're supposed to do, he will continue to give us the living grace so that we can do those things. Right? But he can't demonstrate or give us the living grace if we stop at responsibilities.
Amen.
We never make it that far. If we never start the step of obedience, we cannot experience this living grace. And without saving grace and living grace, you cannot have an abundant life. You will be miserable. You will be joyless. You will be unhappy. You will feel like you've never, accomplished what you were supposed to do in your life. Life will have no meaning if you and I do not experience both saving grace and living grace. We will always feel like we are missing something. And so living grace is a vital part of stewardship. Living grace was the cornerstone of Macedonian stewardship. Go to the next slide, Al. If you look, you will see in chapter 8, that they gave out of affliction. They gave despite their poverty. They gave of their own accord, meaning Paul didn't have to beg them to give and to support their brothers and sisters in Christ. They gave according to their ability. They gave beyond their ability. They gave faith giving. They gave as a ministry to others. And they first, though, in all things, gave themselves and then their money. They gave themselves to God and then they gave their resources. They submitted themselves to God, and then they gave their resources. Verse 5 of chapter 8 says, and not only as we had hope, but they first gave themselves to the Lord, and then to us by the will of God. We'll talk more about that in the weeks to come. And that Macedonian stewardship, as they operated in God's living grace, was to be an example to the Corinthians, according to verse 6 of chapter 8 of 2 Corinthians. And it should be an example to you and I of how living grace can work in our lives to give us the desire, to give us the abilities, and to give us the strength to accomplish God's will and purpose in our lives. So Paul said that this stewardship example should be followed by the Corinthians, meaning it should also be followed by us. And he also, not only did he say for Titus to teach them and encourage them in this discipline, the grace of giving, But he himself said in verse 7, but as you abound in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in all diligence, and in your love for us, see that you abound in this grace also, the grace of giving. And when you and I are proper stewards with an understanding of what living grace is, it will result in an abundance in our lives. It will result in an abundance of joy. Verse 2 of chapter 8 says, that is a great trial of affliction, the abundance of their joy. I don't associate joy with affliction and poverty. But they had joy because they had submitted themselves to God above all things, and they had given what they knew they could give above and beyond what they could give, and so therefore they had a joy that the world cannot take away. They had done everything that they could do to show God how much they loved him and appreciated them for the blessings that they had. And so therefore they had an abundant joy. They abounded in joy because of that selflessness. I don't associate selflessness with joy. No one likes self-sacrifice and associates it with joy. It is not something that I can explain to you. You have to experience it.
Amen.
To understand what that means. Now, I'm a giver. I got that from my mother. My language of love is giving. So by giving people stuff, it brings me joy. How much so then should it give me joy to give to God, who is the source of everything that I have, who showed me his unmerited favor and salvation, but also continues to show me his favor as he gives me the desire and the talents, the gifts and the abilities, as well as the strength because of his grace to accomplish the purpose of the will that he gave or orchestrated for me to walk in.
Amen.
Amen.
Right? That should bring us an abundance of joy. But it's one of those things. Try it, you'll like it. Right? Trying to get your kids to eat a vegetable. Oh, try the broccoli with some salt and pepper on it. You'll like it. Alex is almost 14 years old. Trying to get him to eat vegetables is like pulling teeth out. Right? Trying to convince your toddler to eat a vegetable is like trying to convince Christians to give and that it'll bring them some sort of satisfaction. The nutrient benefits of vegetables to your child that they cannot see or appreciate till they're older and they experience that in their life. You and I cannot appreciate the spiritual nutrients and benefits of giving to our lives until we do it. Right? An abundance of supply. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 6 says, but this I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Here's the thing. Heard a pastor used to say years and years ago, he said it all the time. And I laughed at him, though, because I really didn't know what he was saying. I was just a teenager. He said, if God can get it through you, he will get it to you. You've probably heard that before. That means it can't stop in you, because if it stops in you and doesn't go through you, there's no long anything left to give you. It stops there. And if something is not, what happens in a body of water if it quits flowing? Oh yeah, it gets stagnant and dirty and nasty, and then nothing can live in it. You and I soak up God's blessing and never let it flow out of us, and we become nasty and dirty on the inside, cynical, angry, bitter misers.
Yeah.
And then we wonder why we're never happy. We wonder why enough is never enough. We wonder why we can never be satisfied. It's because we're too satisfied.
Mm-hmm.
Come on. Too satisfied. It's like when I eat. supposed to eat. Last night I ate a 48-ounce porterhouse.
Oh,
that will be cut out. 48-ounce porterhouse. This brother put that down, French fries, asparagus, a salad, and lots of, yeah, at least I ate about 4 pieces of asparagus, that's right. But I ate a lot of it, and then I was sick afterwards. But while I was eating it, I was good. You know why I could eat all that? Because I've been practicing for a lot of years. Come on, and I made myself sick because I had too much. Maybe you guys aren't hearing what I'm saying. You never feel satisfied, or you make yourself sick because you've been blessed and you never let it flow through you.
Oh, wow.
You never allow it to bless anyone else, and so therefore you selfishly sit on it. Wow. And wonder why I'm miserable.
Wow.
Right? God can't supply if we're so stocked up and not sharing it.
That's good.
Mm-hmm. It gives us an abundance of that living grace that we've been talking about. 2 Corinthians 9:8 says, "And God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that you always, having all sufficiency in all things, may have an abundance for every good work." You and I, as we operate in proper stewardship and understand living grace, it is a circle, and that is grace upon grace, for always available, will never run out. And God says, test me.
Amen.
Test me. Mm-hmm. Test me. It's usually not good to test God. But when it comes to his grace, as it relates to serving him, he says, test me. Let me show you how I can uphold you if you will just rely upon me.
Amen.
Let me show you what I can do in your life financially, what I can do in your family, what I can do with your gifts, your talents and abilities. If you will walk in obedience and living faith, I will just keep pouring out. Pouring out.
Amen.
Pouring out. And listen, I ain't talking necessarily about money.
That's right.
I'm talking about God pouring out and continuing to gift us.
Yes, yes.
Give us strength to keep operating. Give us strength. Let me tell you, my mama is 70 years old. I've never seen a 7-year-old who gets up at 3:30 in the morning, starts work, or gets up her day at 3:30 in the morning, and doesn't go to bed till 10 o'clock at night, and from 3:30 in the morning till 10 o'clock at night is about the Lord's work. And I have trouble coming to church more than once a week. That's living grace. Mama, sorry to embarrass you. That's her saying, God, I'm going to keep doing and trusting you to give me the strength and the resources to keep doing it. Oh, I'm 70 years old. I walk with a cane. But God, I'm testing you. I'm going to keep serving you. I'm going to keep giving. I'm going to keep going to the nursing home every week. I'm going to keep walking and trying to teach children's church every week. I'm going to keep mentoring ladies. I'm going to keep doing. Keep doing. I'm going to be in every ministry in the church. There hasn't been one activity that this church has held that woman has not showed up to. I can't even say that. Come on, listen to me. You want to be old and keep serving God healthfully? You need to serve him every single day and know that God will give you the strength and the abundance to be able to walk when the world says your time should be up.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Put God to the test.
Amen.
You'll be surprised what you can do if you will rely on God's grace to do it. I will be surprised at what I can do physically and mentally if I will put my trust in God and rely upon his living grace to operate in it. But if I'm taking a nap every day for 4 hours a day, that's 4 hours wasted that I can be serving God. If I'm staying up till 1 in the morning watching TV, and then I'm too tired to do what God wants me to do the next day, I'm wasting time. I'm not testing. I'm not walking to God's living grace.
Amen.
Lord, that hurts today. I'm going to have to go home and change my own shoes and put ice on my feet. But it's God's truth.
Amen.
And we will have an abundance of thanksgiving. Chapter 9, verse 11 says, "And while you are enriched in everything for all liberality, which causes thanksgiving through us to God." We in the body, in God's church, most of us don't understand what thanksgiving is.
Mm-hmm.
We are thankful as long as God pours on the blessings.
That's right.
We are thankful as long as we never have to do without anything.
That's right.
We are thankful as long as God does what we want Him to do.
Yep.
See, the problem is true thankfulness towards God cannot take place until you step out and rely on His living grace and do what you thought you could not do or give what you thought you could not give.
Amen. Amen.
Come on. That's when we're thankful. True thanksgiving to God. See, it's not about me and what I did. It's about what God did.
Amen.
True thanksgiving to God happens when you and I accomplish the responsibilities and the purpose that God has given us through His living grace.
Amen.
Then I can truly say with all my heart, oh God, I'm so thankful for You.
Amen.
I'm so thankful for You.
Yes.
Mom, every couple of years when we were kids, would get this wild hair on Thanksgiving Day that we were supposed to go around the table and say something we were thankful for. Now, the irony of it was is my brothers hated it. And I, my brothers and I, hated it. Because we would have a table filled with delicious food. Ham. Turkey and homemade rolls and sweet potatoes and the list goes on. Corn, mashed potatoes, a whole table full of food. But we didn't want to stop for 5 seconds and tell God thank you. Why? Because it was all right there in front of us. Right? It's all right there as a distraction. I can't wait to get my turkey leg. Charlie and I both got the turkey legs. Can't wait to get a hold of the turkey leg and some homemade rolls. No thankfulness.
Wow.
Ungratefulness.
Mm.
See, when God lays it out on a platter for us like a smorgasbord that we can pick whatever we want, we're not thankful. But when we serve Him with nothing and He takes two loaves and five fish and feeds 5,000, now suddenly we got something to be thankful for. Walking in obedience through God's living grace, taking nothing and making something. Taking something small and making something great. That's when you and I can be thankful.
Thank you for listening to this message. We hope that you enjoyed it and were blessed by it. Each month, we have people from all over the world who listen to the messages made available. If you've been blessed by this ministry, would you consider making a donation of any amount to help support us as we continue to reach a lost for Christ? Donations can be made online at www.reviveoc.org or by check at Revive Outreach Church, 411 Chatham Heights Road, Suite 101, Fredericksburg, Virginia, 22405. Thank you for your prayers and your continued support. May God richly bless you.